from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, it trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all see how great is our God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Yes, on all these things shall be added unto you, singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Ask and it shall be given unto you, seek and ye shall find, knock and the door shall be opened unto you, singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God, singing hallelujah, hallelujah. So seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, singing hallelujah, hallelujah.
Good morning. Great to be here today. Great to see everybody out. Crowd's getting bigger at the second service, kind of dwindling in the first service. So, anyway, it's really good to see you. If you're visiting with us, we are certainly glad you're here. If you want to make this your church home and go to work with us here, I'm sure the elders would love to speak with you. So if you'll see one of the ministers, and we can point you out to all the elders or one of the elders, they'll be happy to speak with you about identifying with the Highland Heights Church.
Dear Lord and Father of mankind, forgive our foolish ways. Reclothe us in our rightful mind, in purer hearts thy service find, in deeper reverence praise. In simple faith like theirs who heard beside the Syrian Sea. The gracious calling of the Lord, let us like them without a word rise up and follow thee. Drop thy still dews of quietness till all our striving cease. Take from our souls the strain and stress, and let our ordered lives confess the beauty of thy peace.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we're thankful for this Lord's Day that you've given us, this opportunity we have to come out and worship you, sing these songs of praise, and here in a few moments partake of the Lord's Supper. Heavenly Father, we ask that you be with those that are on our sick list. Heavenly Father, all those who are requesting prayers, be with them and grant them the mercy and peace that they may want. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for a successful week of camp that we just had. And Heavenly Father, now when we turn our eyes to our vacation Bible school, we ask that you be with it through the upcoming week. Heavenly Father, that we strive to spread your name throughout our community. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the church here at Highland. We're thankful for our elders, our deacons, our ministers, all those that are involved. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for all the talents that they possess and bring to us every week. Heavenly Father, we ask that you be with us on throughout this hour, throughout the day. And Heavenly Father, forgive us for our sins. And if we're found faithful, give us a home in heaven with thee. For this is our prayer in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Good morning, brothers and sisters, friends. We are thankful to have you here with us this morning. Let us put on hold the things that are going on in our lives, the chaos around us in this world, for we have something far, far more important to think about at this time. Paul, writing to the Corinthians, said, "The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not the participation in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not the participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the same bread." Let this participation take our minds to the upper room where the Christ and his 12 were gathered together to observe the Passover. And Jesus knew his hour had come to depart from this world to his Father. And it is where he instituted the Lord's Supper. Later, he would suffer beatings, a scourge, a crown of thorns, and in the end, the cross. Why? He loved us so much, and he knew that he was the only one who could pay the price of our redemption, and so he did. We are no longer slaves to sin, and so we owe him all of our love. Will you bow with me? Father, we are so thankful that we have an opportunity to be here as one, as a family. And we ask now that you bless this bread that reminds us of the body of Christ that was given. Lord, that we can have redemption, that we have hope of being with you in heaven. And Father, we pray that we will examine ourselves so we'll be found worthy to partake. And we ask this in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. Will you bow with me? Almighty God, we pray now that you bless this cup that reminds us of the blood that was shed by our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus, and Father, that it cleanses us from all sin, and Father, that we have the hope of eternity with you because our sins are forgiven, that we have been reconciled to you, Lord, through this blood of your Son, our Redeemer, our King. We ask that, Father, you bless us as we partake, that our minds are fully focused on what this truly does mean to us. And we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Though I have not left the pulpit, separate and apart from the Lord's Supper, we have this opportunity to give back. It's a blessing indeed. We can pay our ministers who are definitely worthy of their labors. We can help brothers and sisters who are in need, meet their needs, our neighbors. And we can also help those missionaries who are out sharing the gospel this morning with others. Will you bow with me? Father, it is indeed a privilege for us to be able to give back as we, Father, have been blessed this week, as we have purposed in our hearts to do. Lord, we are thankful that we can be a part of helping each other, helping to further your word, helping those who are in hurt and in need. And Lord, we know that we can give of our time, and we should, and we must. And Father, as we give, help us to give with joyful hearts. In Christ's name, amen.
Okay, children, it's time for your church. I am mine no more. I am mine no more. I've been bought with blood. I am mine no more. Jesus is my Lord. Jesus is my Lord. And he rules my life. Jesus is my Lord. He will come again. He will come again. And he'll take me home. He will come again. And I am mine no more. I am mine no more. I've been bought with blood. I am mine no more. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing, cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, gracious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me till the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Good morning. We are just finishing up an exciting week of camp. I know everything I've heard says that they had a fantastic week. Everything went great. Even though there was a little rain, I don't think it discouraged them at all. I just think they had a fantastic week. So everybody that went to camp, everybody that participated in making that happen, thank you. I think it was a fantastic week. And then we enter right into another exciting week with Vacation Bible School. But all of that kicks off tonight. So we're going to have services at 4 p.m. tonight. What time are we having services tonight? 4 p.m. So if you roll in at 5, I'm going to laugh at you, okay? 4 p.m. And as soon as the services are over, we're going to meet over by the playground there, and we're going to have hot dogs, hamburgers, whatever they're feeding us tonight. And we're going to have bouncy houses and trains, and so we're going to have some fun. We're going to have some fellowship, some fun, and it doesn't matter how old you are, we've got a place for you. And we're going to have an auditorium class Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday night, 7 to 8:30. So come and join us for that. Let's just have a great week of Vacation Bible School. I'm excited about it. I'm excited about what happened this week in camp. I'm excited about what's going to happen this week in Vacation Bible School. And you may or may not know what's happening this morning. There's one thing that I'm pretty sure you don't know, and there's another thing that you might know. I'm being very vague because I don't want to get into it all. We'll do it at the end of service. It's going to be an exciting day. You chose a good day to be at Highland Heights, so thank you for being here today. It's going to be a fun day. Did any of you, maybe I shouldn't ask because you got your kids here, but I'm going to ask anyway. Any of you ever fail a class in school? Well, thanks for being honest. Thanks for being honest. You failed a class? Did your kids just look at you and go, are you kidding? What? You never told me about this. Don't answer this one, okay? This is not a hand raising. Any of you ever failed spiritually? Actually, it is a hand raising. Anybody ever failed spiritually? All right, I'm seeing some perfect people here. Anybody ever failed spiritually? Look around. Every one of us do. It is the human way. It's part of our nature. It's part of the way we're wired. It's our DNA. It's whatever you want to call it. We inherited it from Adam and Eve. All of us at some point or another have failed God. We have failed spiritually. But don't you think it's important that we figure out why? Isn't it important that we try and make sure that it doesn't happen again in the future? And yes, it may happen again in the future. Probably will happen again in the future because we're not perfect. But we can never get to a point where we just accept it and say, it's okay. It's we have grace. We have mercy. Look, I love grace. You know that I do. I talk about grace all the time because without it, we're lost. I'm excited about Jesus Christ dying for me and for you because we have that grace and we want that grace. We need that grace. But aren't we encouraged to limit our failures, to figure out why we're failing and to limit those failures? So this morning, we're gonna take you through a journey of failure. We're going to kind of dissect, autopsy, analyze, whatever you want to call it, a failure in Scripture. Now, there are some that are notable. Probably one of the most notable failures in Scripture is David and Bathsheba. I mean, I'm not sure how you can fail much more than David did with Bathsheba. I mean, not only did he commit adultery with her, but in order to cover it all up, he ended up having her husband murdered. I mean, that's pretty much moral, spiritual failure. Wouldn't you agree? And then we've got Saul of Tarsus. Later become the Apostle Paul, one of the greatest New Testament figures. But this guy, he failed miserably because in his zeal to uphold his Phariseeism and the law, I mean, he literally consented to the deaths of people that believed in Jesus. Now, Jesus finally got his attention on that road to Damascus, and he totally changed and became one of the greatest disciples of Christ ever. But he failed miserably before Jesus got his attention. The failure we're going to study this morning over the next few minutes is the failure of the Apostle Peter. And we all know what that failure is if you're a Bible student. If not, we'll get to it in just a minute. But let's kind of go to the end of Jesus' life. It's the night that he was betrayed and the night before he was crucified. Keith talked about it during communion. They're in this upper room. Jesus institutes what we call the Lord's Supper, communion. He washes the feet of the disciples, and then they end that event, and they go down to the Garden of Gethsemane, and there Jesus prays, and he prays fervently. Luke says that he was praying with such fervency that sweat like drops of blood were dripping off of him, and he was praying that God would allow him to bypass this cup that was before him, as he put it. But in the end, he wanted God's will to be done. And so then we find him being arrested in that garden. and taken away. But here's what's interesting about that event is that all of his disciples, except for two, fled. I mean, they're all in the garden except for Judas, because Judas has gone to get the soldiers because he was betraying Jesus. Judas brings the soldiers arrest Jesus, and all of the other 11 except for Peter and John just disperse. They run away. They're scared to death. And so you're saying, well, Wayne, it sounds like Peter was the good guy, right? Well, we can give him props. We can give him credit for at least following Jesus. But when he gets to where Jesus is, we remember the failure, right? The failure was, once they got there, people started saying, hey, aren't you one of his disciples? Peter said, no, I don't know the man. Later, somebody says, hey, I think I saw you in the garden with this man, Jesus. Aren't you one of his disciples? No, I do not know the man. And then finally, this lady says, look, I think you're one of them. You're Galilean. Your speech betrays you. And the Bible says he began to curse. Actually, if you look at the original language, he brought a curse upon himself. In other words, he was saying, if I know Jesus, then may lightning come down and strike me. I do not know the man. Utter failure. Utter failure. And before any of us sit here this morning and say, well, at least I've never done that, the fact is we all have. We have all abandoned Jesus at times. Maybe it's in the classroom when somebody was espousing something that we know God would not be pleased with. Maybe it's in a classroom when somebody is espousing a disbelief that anybody could believe in a God who created the world. Maybe it's at work around the water fountain or around the break room where we began to talk about religious subjects and we deny Jesus. We fail Jesus. Maybe it's in our neighborhoods. It can be anywhere. It can happen anywhere. What we need to know is what are the steps that Peter went through to get there, and try and make sure that we don't go through those same steps. So why did Peter fail? Well, number one, we find that, yes, he did follow Jesus, but he followed him afar off. He followed from a distance. It's not like he ran up to where Jesus was and says, Lord, I'm going to walk with you. I let all these people know that I am with you, I'm for you, I'm backing you. He didn't do that. The Bible says that he followed Jesus from afar off. Look at Luke 22 and verse 54. Having arrested him, talking about Jesus, they led him and brought him into the high priest's house, but Peter followed at a distance. Peter followed at a distance. You see, I think this is what a lot of Christians do. We follow Jesus. We admit that we are disciples of Jesus, but we don't do it nearly that loudly, and we kind of make sure that we stand back a little bit. We don't want to be in the forefront. We don't necessarily want everybody to know that we follow Jesus. We're disciples. We're disciples, but keep it to ourselves, and here's the reality. We're trying to have our cake and eat it too. What we want is a relationship with Jesus, but we don't want the world to know about it. What we want is a relationship with Jesus and eternal life, forgiveness of our sins, but we want it on the down low. We want it cheap. We want it free, right? I want my cake and eat it too. I can be a disciple of Jesus. I get grace. I get forgiveness, and I get to go to heaven. But at the same time, I'm going to live in the world, and I'm not going to let any of my friends or everybody know that I'm a disciple of Jesus. I'm going to follow him from a distance. Well, the problem with that is when we follow Jesus from a distance, eventually we lose sight of him. Eventually we lose sight of him. He's gone. And the next thing you know, we have suffered a failure. In Luke, the 16th chapter, Jesus said, look, no servant can serve two masters. Either he'll hate the one and love the other, else he'll be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Mammon is unhealthy riches. So Jesus is saying, look, you can't serve two masters. And for people that are following from afar, that's exactly what they're trying to do. They're trying to say, Jesus is my master, I follow him. But then they've got these other masters that they're following that they're afraid if people find out that they're disciples of Jesus, it may impact these other things that they're trying to follow, whether it is wealth, whether it is popularity, acceptance in a certain group. Maybe it is just the idea of status. It could even be, listen to this, it could even be preservation of life. Now, I feel pretty sure that nobody in the room today, their lives have probably never been threatened because they're disciples of Jesus. That may happen one day, and that's where Peter was. He was scared that he was going to die, and preserving his life became a master. He wanted to serve God. He wanted to follow Jesus, but you know what? He wanted to do it at a cheap cost, and that cost certainly did not include dying with him. And so he followed from afar off. Look at Luke 9, verses 23 and 24. He said to them all, this is Jesus again, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. Do you see that? Whoever desires to save his life will lose it. That's exactly where Peter was. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. We talked about it last week if you were here. You're either all in or all out. Jesus does not accept us making him a part of our lives. Jesus only accepts being all of our lives, the whole thing. And Peter was just trying to make him a part. And so he followed from afar. And when I look at this, I think, you know what? It's really no wonder that we fail. It's no wonder that we fail because we don't have this all-in mentality. We don't have this walking beside Jesus mentality. We follow Jesus from afar, and we try and keep it quiet, and we try and make sure that we don't upset anybody else. But here's some other problems with that. When we do that, we really have no spiritual power in our lives because we've already abandoned it. We had no spiritual power. We've already compromised it by saying, I don't want anybody else to know about my relationship with Jesus. The other thing we're finding is that particularly in the last 10, 12, 15 years, that our children are just abandoning the church. And I think one reason our children are abandoning the church is because they've seen their parents' commitment to Jesus, and it's not real. What they haven't seen in their home is somebody that is totally committed to being a disciple of Jesus. They've seen parents, quite honestly, let's be honest, they've seen parents who are following Jesus from afar. And believe me, children pick out those inconsistencies very, very quickly. And so in their mind, what we're teaching them is Jesus isn't really that important. He's only important on Sunday morning. But when you get to work or school on Monday morning, he's not that important. When we have social gatherings in the neighborhood, he's not that important. And we certainly don't talk about him. And children have decided that obviously he's just simply not that important because they've watched their parents try and follow him from afar. And the reality is you cannot win in the Christian life by keeping your commitment at a distance. That's where Peter started his downfall. He followed from afar. Number two, we find out that he followed the wrong crowd. Now, I know throughout the history of mankind, parents, good parents, have always been concerned about who their kids are hanging with. I mean, who are they running around with? Who are their friends? That it's something that every good parent wants to know because we know that when our kids get with the wrong crowd, bad things can happen. Why we've decided that we as adults don't have to follow that same rule or that same warning, I don't know. And so we surround ourselves with ungodly people, and then we're surprised when we have some spiritual failure. Now, I am not saying that we shouldn't have friends that are unbelievers. It's going to be difficult for us to share the gospel with the world of people if we don't have friends that are unbelievers. But if you have friends that are unbelievers, you better be the leader. Because if you're following them, you're going to fail. There is going to be a spiritual failure. You better be the leader. But Peter was with the wrong crowd. Look at Luke 22 and 55. When they had kindled a fire in the midst of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Well, who are them? John tells us in John 18. Now the servants and officers who had made a coal of fire, the servants and officers, you know who that was? Those were the people that came and arrested Jesus in the garden. I mean, these are the guys that arrested Jesus, and now Peter's standing around the fire with them. The servants and officers who had made a fire of coal stood there, for it was cold. They warmed themselves, and Peter stood with them and warmed himself. Peter was hanging with the wrong crowd. He was hanging with the wrong crowd. And how many times have we warned our kids, stay away from the wrong crowd? Listen, anybody that discourages you from acknowledging Jesus, anybody that discourages you from walking with Jesus and making him the Lord of your life is the wrong crowd. Anybody. And I don't care if it's your best friend. I don't care if it's your boss. I don't care who it is. Anybody that discourages you from walking with Jesus is the wrong crowd. And that's exactly who Peter surrounded himself with. Now again, as parents, we understand the importance of this. Listen to what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15. It's an interesting passage. Paul says, if in the manner of men I have fought with beasts at Ephesus, what advantage is it to me? It's a long story, but let's summarize it this way. Paul went through a lot to be a disciple of Jesus. He was stoned, he was beaten, he was arrested, he was shipwrecked. I mean, he went through all of these things. And he's saying, look, all of these sacrifices that I made, well, what advantage is that to me if the dead do not rise? If there's no life after death, if there is no heaven, if there is no hell, then why did I do all these things? As a matter of fact, if you don't believe in heaven or hell or a life after this, then our philosophy is more than likely, let us eat and drink for tomorrow we die. And so what Paul is saying is, if I didn't believe in Jesus, if I don't believe that the dead are raised, then I might as well join everybody else and say, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. But then he goes on to say this, don't be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. What's he saying? If you surround yourself with unbelievers who don't believe, they're going to have to stand before God in judgment. They don't believe in hell. They don't believe in anything except eat, drink, and be merry. Let us drink, eat, and drink, for tomorrow we die. If you hang around those kind of people, it will corrupt you. You will fail. You will have a failure. And I don't care if you're 14 years old or 94 years old. When you surround yourself with those people, there will be a failure. And that's where Peter was, with the wrong crowd. So as we analyze this failure, he started by following from afar. He didn't want anybody to know who he was or that he was a disciple. He eventually settled down with the wrong crowd. And number three, we find out that he ignored Jesus' warnings. Look at Luke 22 again. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, that's Peter. Indeed, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail, and when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren. Look at that just for a minute. That's interesting, isn't it? Jesus says, I prayed for you that your faith wouldn't fail, but it's going to. When you've come back, when you've returned, strengthen the brethren. You're going to fail. You're going to fall away. You're going to be gone. But when you come back, strengthen the brethren. But here's Peter's response. But he said to him, Lord, I'm ready to go with you both to prison and to death. This is a mere hours before he denies him. And Jesus warns him. He said, look, I tell you, Peter, the rooster shall not crow this day before you will deny me three times that you even know me. Lord, I'm ready to go with you. I'll go with you to prison. I'll go with you to death. And just a couple of hours later, he's following from afar. He's denying that he even knows Jesus. He ignored Jesus' warning. This book right here is full of warnings. And just like as a parent, the rules we give to our children is for their good. It's not because we hate them and we just don't want them to have any fun. It's for their good. When we say, don't play in the street, we know why, right? When we say, hey, when you're out in the yard, if you see a snake that's got these little rattle things on the tail, don't pick it up. It's a rule. Don't pick it up. Why? Because it's for your good. Why do we think God made his rules? For our good. It's not to keep us from having fun. It's not to keep us from enjoying life. It's for our good. He gave us warnings. The problem is, the warnings are written in this book. And we've had a generation and a half of Christians that don't read the book. And I promise you, neither Kelly nor myself are going to be able to tell you all the warnings that God has given to us in a 20-minute sermon every Sunday. Oh, okay, 30 minutes, all right. We're not going to be able to do that. This is something that you need to be into. This is something that you have got to get into, because here are the warnings that God has given to you. And if you ignore the warnings, you will fail. If you ignore the warnings, you will have a failure. It's not if, it's when. And so, heed the warnings. Jesus said in John 12, verse 48, he who rejects me does not receive my words, has that which judges him. The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day. The word that I have spoken, right here. The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day. This is the warnings. These are the instructions. You don't want to fail? Stay in the word. You don't want to fail? Heed the warnings. But this is where Peter failed. He followed from afar. He followed the wrong crowd. And he didn't heed the warnings. And if we follow that path, again, it's not if, it's when. It's when. And you and I, we've all seen failure sometimes that was absolutely catastrophic. We've seen Christians lose their families, lose everything they had because they had a catastrophic failure spiritually. Worse, we've seen people that never came back, they lost their souls. They lost their salvation. I know some people say you can't do that. See me afterwards, I'll show you where you can. And I've seen people do it. They lost their salvation because they simply tried to follow Jesus from afar. They got mixed up with the wrong people, and they ignored Jesus' warnings. Next week, we're going to take a journey through restoration because Peter is restored to Jesus. Peter does return, but how did he do that? Because some of us find ourselves in failure, and we don't know how to get back to Jesus. So we're going to talk about that next week. Thank you for being with us today again. Man, today is it's an exciting day, I'm telling you. We've only got, 13 minutes left. This is going to be an exciting 13 minutes. It's going to be a lot more exciting than the last 13, okay? The next 13 is going to be great. Thank you for joining us. Be here tonight, 4 p.m. What time we have in church tonight? 4 p.m. And join us for our VBS kickoff. If you have some failure in your life right now, Listen, the grace of God is so amazing. His willingness to restore us and our position as His children is amazing. We would love to be a part of that in your life. If you want to become a child of God, if you want to be baptized for the remission of your sins this morning, we would love to be a part of that and to assist you in that. If we can help you in any way this morning, we invite you to come while we stand and sing.
I heard the voice of Jesus say, come unto me and rest. Lay down thy weary one, lay down thy head upon my breast. I came to Jesus as I was, weary and worn and sad. I found in Him a resting place, and He has made me glad. I heard the voice of Jesus say, behold, I freely give. The living water, thirsty one, stoop down and drink and live. I came to Jesus and I drank of that life-giving stream. I found in which my soul revived, and now I live in Him. I heard the voice of Jesus say, I am this dark world's light. Look unto me, thy morn shall rise, and all thy day be bright. I looked to Jesus, and I found in Him my star, my sun, and in the light of life and luck, till traveling days are done.
Be seated, please.
All right. So a few years ago, Mike and Julie decided, for whatever reason, to move to Chicago. I don't know. I guess it was a job, right? I mean, it wasn't us. She wasn't trying to get away from us, right? They left us. They went to Chicago, totally devastated us. And then a few months ago, they just kind of showed back up on a Sunday morning, and now they're home. And that's been the most exciting thing in the world. And we've been so excited about them being here. But today it gets more exciting because Grady has decided that he wants to be baptized. And amen? This is so exciting. And we are thrilled. We're thrilled to have Mike and Julie with us and their family. We're thrilled at the decision that Grady has made this morning. And he called me last night, and I thanked him for calling me because it made my night, man. It makes your night when somebody calls and says, hey, I want to be baptized tomorrow. Man, those are the best phone calls. Those are great. And so his dad is going to assist him in this, which again I think is fantastic. And so I'm gonna have Mike and Grady come on up, and they can have the mic.
Good morning, Grady. I know this is something we've talked about a lot, and your mother and I have shared with you. I know you've had a fantastic week at camp, and came back and said you wanted to make a commitment. And that's what we're here to do today. Grady, I'm going to ask you, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died on the cross for our sins and was resurrected to give us eternal salvation?
I do.
Amen. Let me tell you, your mother and I and your sister and your family and all these people here love you very much. We're very proud of you. We're excited for this day, and they're rejoicing in heaven because of it.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. When we 7,000 years, bright shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. O my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let not my enemies triumph over me. Faithful love flowing down from the thorn-covered crown makes me whole, saves my soul, washes whiter than snow. Faithful love calms each fear, reaches down, dries each tear, holds my hand when I can't stand on my own. Faithful love from above came to earth to show the Father's love, and I'll never be the same, for I've seen faithful love face to face, and Jesus is his name. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Story, how Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me, knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing
blood. Well, good morning. We sure have a lot to rejoice about today. Congratulations to Grady and his decision to join the Lord this morning. And we are so thankful to all be here to be able to witness it and celebrate with his family. This is a great, great day. As Wayne mentioned, we've got a lot to be thankful for. We had a great day at camp. Thank to everybody who made it a special week, for everybody that was able to participate in that. But we switch gears quick and we go straight into VBS, which starts tonight. I'm telling you, it's great. I told you in weeks in advance that these first 2 weeks of June were going to be really, really good. And we started VBS tonight. Come on, if you can, 4 o'clock we start. I would ask you what time, but Wayne did. He overkilled that, so you should know by now. But also, remember to stay because we've got all kinds of good stuff out there. Cookout afterwards by the playground. We'll have tables and chairs set up and a great time to be together to kick off our VBS as we do each year when we do this. And please remember to come on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday from 7 to 8:30. There will be an adult class in here that Wayne will be teaching, so there's something for everybody for VBS. So we're excited. It all starts tonight. We're looking forward to that. Also, the portico. The baby bottles are due next Sunday, so if you have one at home and you maybe didn't think about it or you're continuing to fill it up, please do so and bring it back by next Sunday. We're so thankful to be a part of that ministry. And the youth minister search has now gone underway. There's an article in the June newsletter. Please take a look at that if you have any questions, and the details are in there. This next announcement, very important, okay? As you know, since COVID started and affected our church 15 months ago, we have been striving to get back to normal. Now, in case you forgot, what normal was the 9 o'clock Bible class and a 10 o'clock worship. Do you remember that? We actually did that, okay? Well, the goal has been to get back to there, and we have taken it slow. We've taken it safely, and I want to just give you a few things that have helped us make this decision on behalf of the elders and the reopening committee. At the beginning of this year, they had 3,213 active cases in Rutherford County, and now 97. So a huge decline. Our positivity rate was 27% in January, and we have watched that come down to 1.4. And the vaccine is readily available for anybody who wants it. So based on these stats and others and a lot of prayer that we've put into it, we have decided that on July 4th, okay, we will be back to normal. Praise God. Okay, yes, very thankful for that. We are so excited that on that Sunday we will be back to a 9 o'clock Bible class and Bible classes and our worship at 10 o'clock, just like we had before. We pray that, you know, I want to thank the reopening committee and the elders so much time we've put into this to get to where we are, and we really think that we're on the right track, so we've been praying about that. So please, I want to just thank everybody. You know, for 15 months, this has been a roller coaster, okay? Not the fun kind, okay? And we have sweated and struggled, and I want to thank you all because you have been so cooperative to go through this ebb and flow time with us, knowing that we're trying to make the best decisions we can, and we are so thankful for you and ask that you continue to keep that attitude as we go into this. More details will come on how we're going to do it, because communion is something we want to talk about and so forth. Be getting to those in the coming weeks. But anyways, I just want to praise God for that and thank you for your cooperation. Now, in just a moment, Wayne said we got a great, great 15 minutes. And I'm going to tell you, when we finish the prayer, please stay in your seats, because Mark Womack and Josh Barker have a tremendous presentation to make on behalf of some of our children. So let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful to be your children. It is such a blessing to be able to sit here and know that we belong to you and that we have a purpose. And even though we fail, and Lord, we do it, and we know that you know those failures in our lives, but you love us anyway. And we're so thankful that you are a God of mercy and a God of grace and a God of second chances over and over again. Father, it's so hard to find words to celebrate each day that relationship we have with you and with one another. Thank you for Grady and his decision this morning. Thank you for where we are in our reopening process. We thank you for camp that just happened, and we look forward to VBS starting tonight. Bless us, Lord. Help us to stay in your word and stay in your spirit and walk with you each day. We love you so much. In Christ's name, amen. Mark?
All right. It's definitely been a blessing to be here at Highland Heights this morning. And we have one more thing. Thank you all for staying with us. We have a tradition here at Highland Heights that when our kids say their books of the Bible, they enter into the 66 Club, and they get a Bible from the congregation with their name printed on it. So we're very excited to make those presentations this morning to the newest 13 members of the 66 Club. This tradition was started years ago, I believe, by Big Boots standing there in the back. So there he is. So very excited to make these presentations this morning. The kids, one by one, will come up as I say their names. They'll get their Bible from Mr. Josh here, and then come stand up, line up on the stage so that we can all show you how proud we are. Okay? So, Thayer Washer. Brooke Nelson. Mm-hmm. Seth Delaney. Owen Johnson. Gavin Barker. Chloe Anguish. Ren Washer. Brooke Womack. Callie Jane Nelson. Carly Delaney. Kinley Mobbs. And then two that aren't here today, Lorelei Post, and then also a family near and dear to our hearts that recently moved to Arkansas, Elizabeth Krauts. We want to make sure that we recognize them as well. So we're obviously very blessed here at Highland with a great group of kids. We have a great group of volunteers that work in our classrooms, work in Children's Worship, Bible Hour, VBS, and all the different programs. So very thankful for all that they do to help us out. So now we have another tradition here that if you're a member of the 66 Club, at any point in time in your life, we'd like for you to come on up and join us down here in front. There we go. There's the enthusiasm. Big boots. I mean,